I'm yours. This is how I know I'm secure.
Welcome to Charles River Church Online. We're so glad you're joining us. Here it is, a groove slightly transformed, just a bit of a break from the norm. Yeah, you know the song, it's summertime. It is officially summertime, school is out. And again, we say welcome to you. As you're here with us, and if you have children, please check out our River Kids link. We have our information below on River Kids. We have activities for kids. Our team has spent great time really wanting to have something for you and your kids. Secondly, connection card. Please click on the connection card link. We'd love to hear from you. If you have prayer requests, if you have other needs, we'd love to hear from you. And so please just let us know who you are, especially if you're here with us for the first time. We're going to give you just a moment, just a minute, just to give a shout out to someone. Maybe you have friends that you haven't seen in a while and you'd like to just say hello to them. And so we're going to give you a moment to do that right now.
lost your way, and you are sure of what you say, and mistakes aren't what you make. You know what you're doing with me, and with every step I take, I know love will be the way. And your child you won't forsake. You know what you're doing with me.
You're here when I need you, answer when I call you, help my heart believe you're the perfect father to me. And when I can't feel you, sometimes I even doubt you, help my unbelief, you're the perfect father to me.
Cause you're a good, good father.
We are the sons, we are the daughters of God. No matter where we go, we're close to the Father's heart. Though we stumble, He will not let us fall. We are the Lord's and He will never forsake His own. The sons, we are the daughters of God. His love He lavished on us and called us children of the King. His loving kindness, He chose the lowly and the weak. And His heart is good, He is always kind. With the cross He proves, He is on my side. We are the sons, we are the daughters. Daughters of God.
Sing When the Lies.
When the lies speak louder than the truth. Remind me I belong to You. When I can't see past the dark of night, remind me You're always by my side. When the lies speak louder than the truth, remind me dark of night. Remind me You're always by my side. When the lies speak louder than the truth, remind me I belong to You. When I can't see past the dark of night, remind me.
a privilege it is to be called a son and daughter of God. That a holy and perfect God would choose to love us as his children, despite our imperfections, despite our weaknesses. Father, I thank you that we don't have to try to earn your love, God, that you lavish it upon us. We thank you. We love you. Thank you for loving us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, we continue on this week looking at the promises of God. And let me just say up front that we've been very prayerful that these promises would sink deep into your heart and would really shape the way you think and then the way that you live. These promises are so rich and so good for us in these very uncertain times. And we as God's people can be grounded in these times because of God's promises, these truths that we can hang on to and take to the bank. So far, we've looked at God's promise, I will be with you. He says, I will be with you. I'll never leave you or forsake you. We then looked at God's promise, I will reward. God's promise, I will satisfy. And then his promise last week, I will provide. And then today's promise is so good. I'm so excited for you to hear this one. It's, I will strengthen. I will strengthen. So, you know, summer is upon us and it has been hot, so stinking hot this past week. And my wife had an idea just to cool the kids down is to grab the sprinkler and put it up underneath our trampoline and let the water come up through the trampoline while the kids are jumping. They can get wet and cool down. And so she started to set that all up and she went and grabbed the sprinkler and the hose. The hose had a nozzle on it, a spray nozzle. And I saw her over there starting to take off the spray nozzle and it had been screwed on too tight so she couldn't get it off. And I was able to valiantly swoop in and say, let me get that, babe. I got that for you. And so I took the nozzle and started to crank on it a little bit. It's a chivalrous gesture that I do from time to time with things like the pickle jar or the jam or spaghetti sauce. And if I were to be really honest with you, there is like this little part within me that gets a little puffed up when I'm able to rescue her and to take the lid off the jar. I know it's pretty lame, but I kind of enjoy it. And so I was happy to swoop in this moment and save the day and to take the spray nozzle off of the hose. And I started cranking on that and cranking and cranking, and I could not get the thing off. And I'm humble enough to say I had to take the walk of shame to the basement to get a couple wrenches and come back up and get that spray nozzle up. Here's the reality. We have moments in life of strength, and we have moments in life of weakness. Now, listen to what God says through the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29 through 31. It says, he gives power to the faint. And to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. I want us to hear what God is saying here. He says, even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. He reminds us of back when we were young, for those of you guys who are no longer a youth, and you were in the best shape of your life, and you could go, go, go. Then he points to the young men who are these cocky, strong young men who are untouchable, where their physical strength is disproportionate to their mental development. And God says, those young, strong, energetic people, even they will grow weary. Even they will fall exhausted. What's God trying to say? He's trying to say, by pointing to the physically strongest among us, that we will all need God's strengthening. There's going to be times in our lives where we all need God's strengthening, these moments, these seasons, where we need a special allotment of his strength. Maybe you're able to identify some of those moments in the past in your own life. Maybe it was a particular season in your educational pursuits or in your vocational pursuits where you just needed some stamina. You just needed God to give you endurance. Maybe it was a battle with depression and you just needed strength just to get out of bed and get going throughout your day. Maybe it was this intimidating task or opportunity and you needed God's strength just to give you the courage to step into it. Maybe it was a ministry opportunity and you just looked at it and you said, no, this is way beyond me. I can't do that. I would just be in over my head. And you needed God's strength to step into that. Or maybe it was a health challenge and you needed God to strengthen you to press through and to get to the other side of that. Or maybe it's not something that you needed God to help you to do, but you needed God to help you not to do, like to be strong in a particular area of temptation or to overcome an addiction. Or maybe it's just something minor, like you need God to give you the courage to go speak to someone, to explore a new relationship. Whether it's big or small, God wants to help us with all of it. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. In other words, we're all going to need God's strength. At some point in our lives, we all need more strength. And his promise, a few verses down in the next chapter, in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, he says this. He says, "Fear not, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." This is a promise of God for, specifically for God's people. If you were to look up in verse 8, it is for Israel, my servant, he says. It's for Jacob, whom I've chosen. It's for the offspring of Abraham, the covenant people of God. That would be you and me. The promise is, I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you. We have a God who is eager to strengthen us. I want us to leave today and to go be together at Trinity Lutheran Church's parking lot and be encouraged. And I just want us to be encouraged and be emboldened, knowing that God is eager to strengthen us. But I do want us to press in a little deeper, to dig a little deeper, to see how it is that God strengthens us. And so for that, our primary passage for today is 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. If you have a Bible, you can head on over there. You get the church app. We've got the Bible there with a lot of other great resources for you. We'll put it on the screen here for you as well. Before I read it, though, I want to give you a little bit of context for this passage. This is a letter from the Apostle Paul to a church in the city of Corinth, a church that he himself started. And several years back as a church, Charles River Church, we went through the first letter to the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians. And for those of you who are around, you may remember that this was a church that was divided. They were actually suing each other. There were people cutting in line in communion to get drunk off the communion wine. They had favorite pastors and favorite preachers, not unlike where we could go with the smorgasbord of preachers we can find on podcasts and vodcasts and on YouTube, and we can divide over, this one's my favorite, I like this one, I like his style or their style. And in this church, some would say, I follow Paul, and others would say, I follow Peter, he was the one who knew Jesus personally, or others would say, I follow Apollos because he's so eloquent. And so these detractors of Paul here in 2 Corinthians, the detractors of Paul are accusing him of lacking spiritual power. Peter, he knew Jesus, and he was also known for these great miracles. Apollos, he was so gifted as a communicator, but Paul, you're boring. You lack spiritual power. It's said elsewhere in the scriptures that he wasn't very much to listen to. The book of Acts actually gives a story of Paul preaching late into the night. And I guess it gets so boring that this young man named Eutychus, sitting on the windowsill while Paul is preaching, falls asleep, falls out the window, and dies. That's a bad day for a preacher. So you should read Paul's writings. They're very profound to read. But if you want to listen to a well-delivered sermon, you would listen to Apollos. And so the people of Corinth are accusing Paul of lacking spiritual power. And so Paul reluctantly gives them an answer here in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He's very hesitant to go here, but these people are so out there and accusing Paul, the Apostle Paul, of not having spiritual power that he has to give them an answer. And so he's reluctant, but he uses the third person, actually. So that's how hesitant he is to articulate his own experience, that he speaks in the third person. And so listen in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 through 10. And before we read chapter 12, just bear in mind, just above that, in chapter 11, he goes through all these examples of various ways in which he almost died for Christ, by stonings, by being beaten with rods, by being shipwrecked, and hypothermia. So then chapter 12, verse 1, I must go on boasting, though there is nothing to be granted by it. I will go on to visitations and revelations, visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth, but I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Wow. Wow, what a powerful passage from the Apostle Paul, who is so reluctant to answer the accusations about lacking spiritual power that he speaks in the third person. He says, I know a man. There's this man. And then he goes on to describe this man himself, who was caught up into heaven, into paradise, either physically or via a vision, he's not sure. But can you imagine being taken up into heaven? For those of you who are curious about heaven, Paul says, this man says that he heard things and he saw things that are too amazing to even begin to describe. Paul says, I will not boast about what I saw. I mean, I could talk about it and what I would say would be true. It's true, but I won't boast about it because my mission in life is to bring honor to God, not to build a name for myself. So he says, if I'm going to go on boasting about anything, I'm going to boast in my weakness. Now, again, imagine if you were given a glimpse into heaven and you saw incredible things and you learned unbelievable truths about heaven and about God, how hard would it be to not tell other people so they don't think more highly of you than they ought? I mean, that would be so challenging. I mean, I struggle with not boasting about when I beat my wife in a board game. Actually, I don't struggle with that at all. I do boast about beating my wife in a board game. I have no resistance when it comes to talking smack. But listen to Paul, verse 7. He says, so to keep me from being conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn is given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being conceited. So Paul tells us about how amazing the things that he has seen were of heaven, and that God allowed Satan to give him this thorn in the flesh to harass him. Now, let's think about a few words for a moment here. That word harass tells us that it's something that is continually bothering him. Even as he's writing this letter, he is being harassed by something. That word thorn means that it's some kind of sharp, painful issue that's pressing in on him, so difficult that he just cannot overlook it. He cannot ignore it. Its presence for him, one, would cripple him from fully enjoying life, and two, would drain him of energy, preventing him from living life most efficiently. Now, I've always been curious about what this thorn was. There's all kinds of speculation out there from theologians and commentators about this thorn. Most theologians think that it's some kind of physical ailment, since it's called a thorn in the flesh. Some think maybe it was a particular eye issue, because in Galatians chapter 4, Paul says that the Galatians would have gouged out their eyes to give them to Paul. That's how much they loved him. And so we don't know specifically what it is, but I tend to lean that it's probably some kind of physical ailment. I've always been intrigued as I hear this more and more and more about men and women of God who were used in unbelievable ways, who just quietly suffered through intense sufferings. One particular man, the theologian John Calvin, is known for just tremendous contributions to theological thought. But did you know that he suffered miserably from hemorrhoids. Hemorrhoids that often would bleed, leaving him anemic and just lacking strength. He had painful gout, like arthritis in his joints that he often had to preach sitting down. He had frequent kidney stones that just destroyed his insides, leading to all kinds of infections. He battled with migraines. He had strong facial pain going on, insomnia with all of this pain that he's feeling. And then ultimately he dies of tuberculosis. Tuberculosis. The Apostle Paul has a thorn in the flesh. John Calvin had all these thorns in his flesh. Why though? Why? I mean, here is this man that God will use to bring the gospel, the good news of Jesus, to all kinds of metropolitan cities. Here's a man who will lead church planting movements and turn whole cities upside down. God, why not give him more power? Why not zap him of his energy and force him to preach sitting down, so to speak? Force him to preach from quarantine, so to speak, because he's on house arrest or teaching through letters from prison. Why not give him more authority, more power? Why allow him to be harassed with this constant pain point stabbing into his flesh? Why not allow his faithful preaching to be coupled with the eloquence of Apollos? Why give him a thorn, God? And God tells us, he says, Paul, it's to keep you from being conceited. To keep you from being conceited. Paul goes on, he says, I pleaded with God in prayer 3 times to remove this thorn from me. I beg God, please take this from me, until Jesus himself speaks to him and says, no, Paul, no, my grace is sufficient for you. My power, catch it, is made perfect in weakness. We often want to claim those promises of God, as we see in the scripture, for his power, for his strengthening. But do you know that he says you get that in weakness? In your weakness. If Paul were like a balloon, just so he doesn't puff up and inflate with his role and the opportunity to see heaven, God has given him this thorn to continue to prick the balloon, to prick the pride, to deflate him of any potential pride. And Paul says, in so doing that, and being deflated in that way, God's power is now able to fill me. God's power is now able to inflate me in ways that otherwise might not have happened. And so Paul says, I'm not going to boast in my own strength. I'm going to boast in my weaknesses. I will be content in my weaknesses and the insults that come my way, the hardships that come my way, in the persecutions that come my way, in the calamities that come my way. Because, verse 10, when I am weak, then I am strong, as God's power is shown through my weakness. Now, it's one thing for us to look at the Apostle Paul. It's another thing to look at our own lives, when there's something in our lives that we could equate to the thorn. Now, I don't want to compare our struggles to that of Paul. I think Paul had just tremendous difficulty, probably far greater than what we've personally experienced, or at least I've experienced. But we all have our own thorns. It could be physical, it could be relational, it could be emotional, it could be personality, it could be something else. But I want us to think about this for just a minute. This thorn of our very own that we might have, these things that we think, why? Like, God, why? If it weren't for this particular area, I could be so much more effective for you, God. So let's think through those for just a moment. We all have our thorns, no matter the size, whether it's Paul size or smaller. Whatever the size of your thorn, we have thorns. Maybe it's a physical issue. Some of us have health issues that are just so hard to understand. God, why would you allow me to endure this? We know that God could certainly remove it. We read about healings in the scriptures often, and you should pray for that. Paul prayed for his to be removed. And so maybe there's a physical issue. Maybe it's a relational situation. Maybe you thought you would be married by now, or you thought that the marriage that you're in would look a lot differently. Or maybe it's a relational issue where, like Paul, he had these constant agitators, these people. Some people would say that his thorn in the flesh were these people that were constantly opposing him. And I'm sure some of us have those people in our lives that we just can't understand why God would allow them to remain in our life. And you maybe have felt like, if this person wasn't in my life, I could be so much more effective And so that could be a thorn. It could be an emotional issue. Maybe you're prone to depression or you're prone to anxiety. I think about the Prince of Preachers, Charles Spurgeon, who just wrote countless volumes of just all kinds of powerful content, delivered unbelievable sermons, but he speaks often about his dark night of the soul. He says this, he says, "I am the subject of depression so fearful that I hope none of you ever have to get to such extremes of wretchedness as I go to." So it could be that emotional issue. It could be a personality deficiency. Have you ever thought, if I were only more quick-witted, or if I were only more dynamic, or if I were only more outgoing, or if I was only more a strategic thinker? I mean, you could go on and on. Are any of these resonating with you? Maybe it's something else. For me, as a pastor, I'm very acquainted with my own weaknesses, and I often feel like I'm in over my head. If I were to be really honest, sometimes I feel like if people only knew how incompetent I were, they would probably go to another church. They would probably go find another church with a pastor who's more educated, who's more holy, who's more of a strategic thinker, who's more articulate. They'd go somewhere else. I'm very acquainted with my own weaknesses. Maybe you're just getting acquainted with your weakness, or if you've been around for a long time, you're like, hey, I'm very familiar with what it is for me. Now, what does Paul do with his thorn? What he does is he sees it as something that keeps him humble and keeps him prayerfully dependent on God. In fact, you probably passed over a very important word that he used. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, he says, "Given." A thorn was given to me. I want you to hear this word. It's so important. Your thorn is a gift. Your thorn is a gift. Listen, anything that God gives you to keep you humble and to keep you more dependent on Him is a gift, even if it causes you pain. God will cause His children some affliction, knowing that without it, we can often become puffed up and inflated and self-reliant, which in the end causes even far greater pain than the thorn itself. Imagine today if God handed you a gift box and He says, "I have something for you. This is so beautiful. This is so powerful. This is a very important gift that I have for your life." And you open up this gift box, and inside it is a thorn. You wouldn't get it. You probably wouldn't immediately understand it, but I imagine that over years, 10, 20, 30, 50 years, you begin to realize, wow, that was a gift. That was a gift from God. He gave this to me to keep me humble, to keep me reliant upon Him. And as I was reliant upon Him in the midst of the weakness and in the midst of the challenge and in the midst of the deficiency, He showed Himself strong. And I was able to experience the power of God in ways that I would have never experienced had He not given me this gift, this thing that the world doesn't see as a gift. But God says, no, this is a gift for you. It's for you. So you didn't think you were going to get one of those TV sermons about God's power and victory, did you? No, that's not how I roll. Listen, I think the world wants to give us a sermon, and maybe just typically we want to kind of get the sermon like Popeye the Sailor Man about strength. That was kind of one of my cartoons I watched growing up, Popeye the Sailor Man, and he would just be this average sailor man, and then he would, you know, take the spinach and suddenly his muscles would just inflate. And I think a lot of times that's what we want. We want to be ourselves, just exactly who we are. And then we want to put a little Jesus on top and get that extra dose of power. Our muscles start to bulge and we start to do incredible things. But it's not that. It's not that at all. There's some deflating that needs to take place first. It's not your muscles plus God's muscles on top. It's you deny yourself, God fills you back up. God fills up that space, and you are stronger than you would have otherwise been without the deflating that comes from that thorn, that pricking. It is so important. And so our promise from God, I will strengthen you. I will strengthen you. And how? I will strengthen you by allowing you to be reminded of your weakness and then to have a new perspective on your weaknesses and say, wow, that's actually a gift, because when I'm weak, God proves himself strong. Let me pray for us. Our Father in heaven, we are thankful that you do give us your strength, that you are eager to provide us with your strength. And God, yet at the same time, it does frighten us to think that in order to receive your strength, we have to be humbled. We have to go through some tough stuff in life. But God, thank you that you are so gracious and you are so good that you allow the negative things in our life to make us stronger, and you choose not to remove some difficulties that we need to go through to help us to be reliant on you. And so God, I pray for my friends who are watching right now that they would be reminded of the difficulties, the areas that they've seen as shortcomings and great difficulties in their lives, and they would be able to have a new perspective and look at them as gifts from you, that you would show yourself strong through those weaknesses like you did with the Apostle Paul, who wasn't a great orator necessarily. From the Apostle Paul, who had some kind of physical ailment that was just plaguing him, but in the midst of the weakness, in the midst of the difficulty, you showed yourself strong. And so God, we do plead with you like Paul, that you would remove whatever it is that's on our minds right now, whether it's a physical ailment or it's an emotional struggle or some kind of deficiency. Lord, we do pray that we would be developed in that and grown past that. But we also trust that if you choose not to remove that from us, it's a gift and you're good and you're working all things together for good. And so God, we claim your promise to strengthen us. Give us strength for whatever's in front of us. And Lord, give us that strength however you choose to dispense that strength to us, whether it's through weakness, you show yourself strong, or some other means, God. But Lord, we look to you and we know that you are the one who is strong. You are the one who is mighty. And so we cast these things on you, knowing that you care for us and that you are strong and that you are able. Make much of yourself so that we can boast not in ourselves, but in you. And God, I pray right now for any of my friends who are watching right now who do not know Jesus, who have not placed faith in Jesus. God, I pray that the humbling that they would experience right now would be the humbling of realizing that they cannot save themselves, that they cannot earn your favor, but that you love them so much that you sent your son Jesus to die for them, to pay the price for their sin, that you did the work that they could not accomplish by paying the price for sin on the cross and resurrecting to life and strength from the dead. And so God, I pray that the humbling that would take place in their hearts right now, as those who do not know Jesus, who have not trusted in Jesus, would be a humbling of just realizing they're sinful and they're separated from you, and that they would look to you and you would show yourself strong and victorious over Satan, sin, and death, that they right now in faith would become a child of God. Let me say this, if that's you and you're watching right now and you've never given your life to Christ, let me invite you right now to call upon the name of Jesus. The Bible says, if you call upon the name of Jesus, you will be saved. Be humble enough to say, God, I need you. And he will bring you into his family and you become his child. And when you become his child, these promises apply to you. So God, I commit them to you. We love you. We thank you so much for the time that we've had together to open up your word and to hear from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Josh, thank you so much for that word to remind us about how God uses our weaknesses and our challenges and our struggles in ways that can actually be used for his glory. Yeah. Because oftentimes we're ashamed of things that happen to us, but actually knowing that God can use that to encourage us and encourage others, that's such a blessing.
Yeah, totally. And so I imagine that we've got some things to kind of process out. And so we want to give you some space to do that by just giving you a couple of reflection questions, just to think on what's been shared, what the scripture says, and really help you to take this sermon and let it to just go with you throughout the week. So here's your first reflection question. Question number one for you is, what are your areas of perceived weakness? And so it's important just to know, I'm sure you know, I know for myself, just areas of weakness, and I've seen God step in spite of those weaknesses and show himself strong. So identify those right now. If you're with some other people, if you're comfortable to say it out loud, that would be great. If you're by yourself, maybe you just want to write it down in a journal somewhere and just acknowledge your areas of weakness.
Mm-hmm. And second question is, how have your weaknesses helped you to depend more upon God? You know, oftentimes, as I mentioned earlier, our weaknesses bring shame and pain and sometimes can keep us away from God. But God wants us to have these experiences so that they draw us closer to Him. So if you look at your life right now, how would you say your weaknesses have drawn you closer to Him and closer to really being in His presence?
Yeah. So take some time with those two questions, and I think that'll really help you just to process out what we've talked about today. Hey, we want to wrap up by just pointing you to a few things. First of all, I want to point you to that connection card. We really do pray for you guys. And so if you would take some time with that connection card, let us know that you're here. Maybe let us know if today you've decided to trust in and follow Jesus. We want to celebrate that with you. Let us know how we can be praying for you. So take some time with that link, if you would, as we wrap up in just a moment here. That would be great. And then also, we just want to invite you in to be generous. We as a church love being generous in our community, meeting needs in our community, especially in this COVID season. And so if God's just impressed on your heart to give, there's a link we're going to drop in right now for you. You can click that link and you can give through the link. You can also give through the church app, or you can give by just mailing in to the church P.O. box. So take some time with that if you would. And we just want to say thank you for your tremendous generosity in this season.
Mm-hmm. And also, River Kids. We love kids. Anyone knows Charles River Church? There are kids everywhere when you come on a Sunday. But we have our River Kids lesson for you families who are thinking, man, what should I do over the summer? I'm looking for activities. Our team has really developed some great materials to encourage kids, to encourage families to work together. I even know our family personally, we painted some rocks with some scriptures. And so when our neighbors come by, they can see the rocks and know kind of what we value as a family. And so we encourage you to check out the activities in River Kids.
Yeah. Good stuff. And then the last thing, we have just recently started phase one of our regathering plan. And so right after this gathering, as you wrap up, take some time with those reflection questions. And then we want to invite you to Trinity Lutheran Church in West Roxbury. We're going to drop in the directions for you in just a moment here. But between 11:30 and 12:30, you can drive through at any time. And we're going to have some gifts for the kids, some gifts for the adults. We're going to have communion and prayer time for you. And so you don't even have to get out of your car. Your kids can stay in their jams if they want to, but take some time in just a moment and drive through Trinity Lutheran Church, West Roxbury. We're real excited to see you. And so we'll both be there, and we'll get to pray with you and just give you a little something. So thanks so much for being with us today. It's been a good Sunday together. Hopefully we'll see you in person. If not, have a great week.
Thank you.